Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
Inshallah, Sheikh Al-Rafa will be going through the story about Musa and Khidr. It'll take, you know, about an hour or so, and then inshallah, you're free to go. And again, next week, we will be having Mount Shahid, the final story in our series. And then also next Saturday evening, for those who are familiar with this community and have been here for many years, the program with Dr. Ahmed Siddiqui on the journey through the hereafter will be after Taraweeh on July the 11th, I believe it's Saturday evening. So alhamdulillah, we've been able to fly him into town to do that program as well. That will be post Taraweeh next Saturday evening. So inshallah, keep in mind those programs so you can be rested and ready to come for those inshallah.
الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا من يهد الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا واشهد ان لا اله الا الله القوي المتعال الجبروت والملكوت والكبرياء والعظمه واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله بلغ الرساله وادى الامانه ونصح الامه صلى الله عليه وسلم. We are gathered, inshallah, today to study part of the Quran. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Majtama'a qawmun fi baytin min buyutillah." Every time that group of people come to learn, they come together in the house of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala to reflect, to understand the book of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. Illa hafathum al-malaika wa ghashiyatuhum rahmah. And Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala, the malaika will surround them. And the mercy, inshallah, will come upon us, inshallah, today. So it's about a story that's different than any other story in the Quran. It's about a story that it's not about a messenger, it's not about a prophet, but it's about a journey and a part of the experience that Musa alayhi salam had. Musa alayhi salam is very special in the Quran when it comes to the stories, more than any other messenger or any other story. The story of Musa alayhi salam been mentioned in the Quran more than 180 times. The story of Musa alayhi salam started before birth, after birth, started when he get married, started about his struggle, talked about almost every part of the life of Musa alayhi salam. And this story comes as a very important part of his life alayhi salam, and came in the context, very special context. And Imam al-Razi, very important tafsir. Mafatih al-Ghayb, tafsir al-Kabir. One of the greatest tafsir that it's very deep, has the depth, is the name al-Tafsir al-Kabir, then Imam al-Razi. He said very important introduction to the story. He said you have to connect the story with the two stories you came before in Surah Al-Kahf. This is Surah Al-Kahf. In front of you, there is the four stories, big part of it. This is the story of Musa alayhi salam and Al-Khadr or Al-Khidr. So the introduction, they say this story has a great role and we don't understand it well without connected with the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the challenge that the people of the book, they did and they asked the mushrikeen of Quraysh. I'm sure we talked about it in Surah, in the story of Al-Kahf. The people of the book, they have a meeting. They had a meeting with some leader of the mushrikeen of Quraysh. And this meeting, they said, we want to teach you, the Jews in Medina, some of them. They said, we're going to teach you something to challenge the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We're going to tell you about this question. He cannot answer your questions. So from this arrogant, and this is what the story about, they said, we're going to tell you, go to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and ask him about Ashab al-Kahf. For sure he's not going to have an answer. And you're going to embarrass him. And you're going to show him he doesn't know. As the challenge, it's about you know or you don't know. So the beginning of the story, Surah al-Kahf, it started with this question. The mushrikeen of Quraysh, they learned something from the Jews around them and say, we're going to challenge you. Oh Muhammad, what you know about the people of the cave? The young people of the king, and the surah revealed as an answer to this challenge. Story of Musa came in this context. Does the knowledge make you a good person or not? Does the knowledge, if you answer every question, make you somebody good, somebody truthful or not? So Quran said, it's not about how much you know. It's not about, because this is the challenge of Bani Israel, and not only Bani Israel, but the tradition, religious institutions. When they come, they test you how much do you know. When you go to test or you go to institution, religious institution, they're going to give you a test. How much do you know? How many stories do you know? How much Quran do you memorize? This is how the institution works. Allah went to tell them the approach of the institution, and the greatest religious institution is the institution established by the children of Ishaq. 16th, as we mentioned, prophet and messenger, they came from the lineage of Ishaq. The last one, the first one, Ishaq alayhi salam. The last one is Isa alayhi salam. What this lineage, and this is why Isa alayhi salam came to challenge the system that the Bani Israel, they put it. They put it there, a very strict religious system. You cannot come out of it. It's about you be part of it. Isa alayhi salam was the revolution against this system that they put. Test you with the knowledge, with your connection, with your blood, with your, everything that it's they put. Allah went to tell Bani Israel that Musa alayhi salam, this great man, Kalimullah, there is nobody has knowledge at his time more than him, except the Khidr. We're going to see this. That Musa alayhi salam, Allah tested him, and Allah wanted him to go through this amazing experience of humbleness. Experience to tell not only Musa alayhi salam, but everybody until the day of judgment, that your knowledge, it's not everything. Why? Because Allah said in Surah Yusuf, وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. Everybody has knowledge, there is somebody who has more knowledge than him. And this is the experience. So the experience, the story, this is, it's about the purpose of the surah in the beginning. It's about tawheed, it's about accepting the truth, it's about humbleness, it's about protection, it's about learning, and this is one of the great, the first purpose of the story. It's experience of humbleness. The second purpose, which is a great purpose, it's to make us accept the qada and accept things that we cannot explain, we cannot rationalize, accept things that happen to us and we don't see the ultimate purpose of it. And this is a healing. This is what the story about. First one is experience of humbleness. Number two, it's the healing for the qada, things that happen to us, and this is what we're going to talk about. How the story started. The Rasulullah is in al-Bukhari narrated this reason of the story. Musa alayhi salam stand up to give a lecture. And he gave an amazing lecture to Bani Israel. Many people, they said they had this power of talking. Isa alayhi salam, Musa alayhi salam, even though he asked Allah to send Harun with him. And they think Harun has afsahu minni lisan, he speak better than me. But Allah gave Musa the ability, the knowledge, and give him the ability also to teach. After the lecture finished, one of the audience, and always these people who try to come closer to the teachers and to come to him, he said, you think there is anybody has more knowledge than you? This is the most dangerous people. People who put the kibr inside you. Rasulullah said, be careful from al-maddahit. These people who came just to try to make you big and increase. These are the disaster for any person who going to learn. Because Rasulullah, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُ الْمَدَّحِينَ, when you see these people who do the madh, throw the dust on them. Means don't let them ruin you. As Rasulullah said, to talk to somebody, he came and start talking good about, you are amazing, you are this, you are this. Rasulullah said, لَقَدْ قَسَمْتَ ظَهْرَ الرَّجُلِ. You break his back. You destroy him. If the people, they are not the teachers and the scholars and the people, anything doing things good, if they're not aware about the dangers, this is can be the worst thing that shaitan do to you. So if somebody come to you and to try praising you and praising repeatedly, you know there's something wrong there. So this guy, he stand up and he said to Musa alayhi salam, I don't think, we ask him, come form of question, do you know anybody who has more knowledge than you? Musa alayhi salam is an honest person. He said, I don't know. I don't know if there is anybody in this earth who has more knowledge that Allah gave it to me. I am Rasul, I am Nabi, I am Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Kaleemullah, Allah talk to me. I don't think there is somebody in this earth who has more knowledge. He didn't say it from arrogance, he said it from honest answer. Immediately the wahi came to Musa alayhi salam. He said, you are wrong. He said, why? There is somebody on the earth who has more knowledge than you. Musa alayhi salam, he didn't get angry. Sometimes when challenging, you're not everything. There is somebody better than you. He didn't get disappointed experience of why I thought I'm everything. But immediately, Musa alayhi salam, he asked Allah, oh Allah, show him to me. I want to learn from him. This is how the story started. So Musa alayhi salam asking Allah to show him the source of the knowledge, to show him somebody who has more knowledge than him to learn from him. And this is how the story. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know the story, Allah gave him a sign. He said, go direction of the ocean, of the sea, and take a fish with you. When the fish disappeared, when you lost the fish, you know, this is the place where you see this man. He took his fatah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he called him Yusha ibn Nun. Yusha ibn Nun, in many riwayat, he himself is a prophet. And there is hadith talking about this fatah, this young man, that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he is the only person that Allah frees the sun for him. He was in Ghazwa, and in this Ghazwa, it was, they have a rule at the time when the sun set, there is no fighting anymore. So it was they almost win the Ghazwa, and the sun very close to set. He said, at the time, he said this word. He said, "Anti ma'mura wa ana ma'mur." You are talking to the sun, you are ma'mura by Allah, you are under the control of Allah, and I'm under the control of Allah. If you can, let me, give me chance, give us to open the city, and Allah will be. So the sun, Rasulullah said, the sun froze, delayed, and until they opened the city. So this fatah, he was a young man learning from Musa alayhi salam. So Musa alayhi salam, he said, let's go to this journey. And let's go, the story started from here. وَقَالَ مُوسَى لِفَتَاهُ لَا أَبْرَحُ حَتَّى أَبْلُغَ مَجْمَعَ الْبَحْرَيْنِ أَوْ أَمْضِيَ حُقُبًا. He said, I have a determination. I want to arrive to the conjunction of the two seas, place where the two seas come. It is many riwayat, but the strongest one, some people said, is the when the intersection of the blue and the white Nile. You know where is the both of them connect? Anybody Ethiopia. From Sudan here?
Ethiopia? No.
Nobody from Sudan. Yeah, from Sudan. So where is the blue Nile and the white Nile come together? In Khartoum. This is the first riwayah. It's not very strong, but the strongest one is the Red Sea. The Red Sea in the south of Sinai. There is two entrance of the sea, and this is the conjunction when the two seas comes together in this riwayah. Most probably the second one, because of the location of Musa alayhi salam, and closer to Egypt. And so he tells his follower, قال لَا أَبْرَحُ حَتَّى أَبْلُغَ مَجْمَعَ الْبَحْرَيْنِ أَوْ أَمْضِيَ حُقُبًا. Very powerful statement. He said, I'm not going to stop walking until I arrive to Majma al-Bahrain, or I'm going to keep going. Huqba means, al-Huqba is 10 years. He said, even if take me years to achieve this goal, to go and to learn, I'm not going to give up. And this is the beginning of the story. It starts from this determination of Musa alayhi salam to learn. And Musa alayhi salam is great, he's a messenger as we mentioned, but he said, I want to learn something that I don't know. So he starts, فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَجْمَعَ بَيْنِهِمَا نَسْيَ حُوتَهُمَا. So when they arrive closer to this area, when Allah asks them to go, they forget this fish. Fish is hoot, is the fish. This fish was a dead fish. And they took it with them, they put it in their bag, and they put the food with them, and they just put it as a sign. And this is the symbolism of the importance of the sign. Many of the Sahaba, many of the Salihin, always they ask for clue, for a sign in their lives. And this is what the idea of the istikhara is. Allah, give me alam, give me a sign, give me an indication. When I see it, I know that I'm in the right path. I see it, I know this is the time. There is nothing wrong when you make your dua, you ask Allah to show you a sign so that your prayer will be clear and you don't miss them. So Allah gives him a very clear sign. He said, when you lose this fish, you know that you are in the right place. So they forget about it. فَلَمَّا بَلْغَ مَجْمَعَ نَسْيَ حُوتَهُمَا فَاتَّخَذَ سَبِيلَهُ فِي الْبَحْرِ سَعْمًا. So his fatah, he didn't notice, there is many riwayat about it. When they sit to eat, there is a rock, and they took the bag and they forget about the fish. And they keep going for long distance. Until another, the second time, Musa alayhi salam, he asked him, قَالْ فَلَمَّا جَاوَزَ قَالَ لِفَتَاهُ آتِنَا غَدَانَا. When they passed by the distance, they said, okay, let's have lunch again. When he opened the bag, he didn't find the fish. Musa alayhi salam was very happy. And the young man said, قَالَ عَرَأَيْتَ إِذْ أَوَيْنَا إِلَى السَّحْرَةِ فَإِنِّي نَسِيتُ الْحُوتِ وَمَا أَنْسَانِيهِ إِلَّا الشَّيْطَانُ وَأَذْكُرَهُ وَاتَّخَذَ سَبِيلَهُ فِي الْبَحْرِ عَجَبًا. So they find out that they didn't find the fish. It was a very good news for Musa alayhi salam, because this is what Allah asked to tell him. When you lose the fish, you know this is when you're going to find the man. So he said, and the young man was surprised. He said, how I didn't find out about this fish? So what the Mufassirin said, he said, when they sit next to this rock and they open to eat, they open their bags to eat, they said the fish, the life come back to the fish, and the fish go to the sea and to the water. And this is the first time of this completely new and different world of knowledge. It's about life coming back. It's about new dimension of knowledge that nobody knows. It's not our level of knowledge. So Musa alayhi salam, he said, let's go back and go to the place when the fish disappear. قَالْ خَالَ ذَلِكَ مَا كُنَّا نَبْغِي. This is what we've been looking for. It's a good news for them. The boy, he was a little bit worried how I lose the fish and I don't know. But for Musa, it was, this is the good news, and this is the indication. This is مَا كُنَّا نَبْغِي. يَبْغِي مَا كُنَّا نُرِي. This is our purpose of this. قَالَ فَوَجَدَ when they come back, فَرْتَدَّ عَلَىٰ أَثَرِهِمَ قَصَصَ. They come back looking for the tracks, how they came from. So until they arrive to this Sakhra. And we arrive there, something amazing, based on many tafsir happened. The Sakhra was, the area was very dry, no vegetation. It was no green. And when they come back, they saw the Sakhra, they saw this man covering his face and sitting there, and the area become very green. All the vegetation, and this is the second one. The first one is the fish, the second one, this is the greenness that it happened in a few maybe hours or few one day or so. So and this is Musa alayhi salam, he started finding what kind of man is this. He came to him, and many Mufassirin say he waited. He was laying down this man and he waited, and this is one of the manners of learning. Don't push and rush. Wait until the right proper time to ask. So when he will wake up, Musa alayhi salam, he say, assalamu alaikum. The answer of this man, Al-Khidr or Al-Khadr, was the following. He said, where's the peace in your land? What kind of peace? This is one of the interpretation. That he asked me, he said, you say salamu alaykum to me, where is the peace? Where is the peace? Anna lissalami fi ardikum. There is no, where is the peace in your land? And another riwayah, he said, he told him, how do you know about as-salam, the peace? He asked him, who are you? He said, ana Musa. Al-Khidr, he told him, Musa Bani Israel. Are you Musa of Bani Israel? قال نعم. He knows about Musa Bani Israel, but it's very far from where we are. So this is start the first discussion between Musa and this man. What Musa alayhi salam, قال Allah said, فَوَجَدَ عَبْدًا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا آتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِنْ عِنْدِنَا وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا عِلْمًا. This is the description of this man. عَبْدًا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا. The first one is عَبْد مِنْ عَبِيدِ اللَّهِ. It's not somebody who came from different planets. He's عَبْد of عَبِيدُ اللَّهِ. This عَبْد has something different. قَالْ آتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً. We gave him a mercy. And this is why a lot of Mufassirin, they said he was a prophet. Because the Rahmah in the Quran being repeated as indication of the revelation of the wahi of the mercy. This is many Mufassirin, they believe he was a prophet. He's Abd and he was a prophet. قَالْ أَتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِنْ عِنْدِنَا. The first one, Allah gave him a mercy. His mercy could be the prophecy, the prophethood. And the second one, وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا عِلْمًا. And we taught him a knowledge from us. And this is open a whole chapter in the history of Islam about what we call al-ilm al-laduni. What's al-ilm al-laduni? Ghazali talked about a lot about this al-ilm al-laduni. Al-ilm al-laduni being presented as a knowledge, as Imam Ghazali said, that you don't get it through your senses, and knowledge that you don't get it through the rational analysis. Very similar to wahi, but it's different than the wahi. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. So it's a knowledge, Imam Ghazali said, that you get it without using your rational and without using your senses. And this is that they're going to see this kind of knowledge. They're different than any knowledge that we know. It's different than the wahi. It's different than rational knowledge. It's different than the senses knowledge. So this is the first description of this man. Allah gave him special knowledge, and this special knowledge is going to make him, to give him the ability to see things that the rest of the people, they don't see. Here, the man, when he find out about Musa alayhi salam, he said the following. He said, Allah gave you knowledge that he didn't give me. And Allah gave me a knowledge that he didn't give you. This is a humbleness, but also to tell Musa to don't degrade him. There is people and somebody come to ask them. They bring them down. Oh, you are asking me. You don't know. But Al-Khidr alayhi salam, he said that Allah gave me a different kind of knowledge. And Allah gave you a knowledge that I don't know about. And here come what kind of different knowledge? The knowledge of Musa alayhi salam and all the prophets, it's the knowledge of the Dhah and the knowledge of the Sharia, the knowledge of the ruling, the knowledge of the Day of Judgment. But this knowledge, it's a knowledge about the reasons of things, how things happen, why, and what's motivating this. And this is very important to understand that this kind of knowledge, many scholars they said, everybody can get something similar to show you the far deep reason of happening, why things happen. And this is the knowledge that Musa alayhi salam doesn't have. And this is the knowledge that Musa alayhi salam traveled days to come and to get it. So this is the first definition of this knowledge. I repeat the ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَوَجَدَ عَبْدًا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا آتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِنْ عِنْدِنَا وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا عِلْمًا. So now, the first question that Musa alayhi salam asked Al-Khadr or Al-Khidr, he said, قَالَ لَهُ مُوسَى هَلْ أَتَّبِعُكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُعَلِّمَنِي مِمَّا عُلِّمْتَ رُشْدًا. With the humbleness, with polite and he said, "Can I follow you to teach me from what Allah taught you?" Who's asking? It's not me or you. This is Musa alayhi salam. And this is the greatest message, humbling, the humbleness, and this is the experience. And every experience that we have that show that we don't know. I always give the example about, I remember when the first time we used the telescope to look to the planet Jupiter. I remember the first shot for me that just to, as you see these days, Venus and Jupiter, they are very close to each other. And this is happening here, beautiful, the two planets in the west. If you don't see them, take a moment to see. The first thing to find out that the star is not a star, it's a planet. It was like bring you from one this dimension to another dimension. But to look to this, to use the telescope, and to see the planet, and to see the moons around the planets, this is to bring you to another completely dimension that I didn't know about this. And this shock, it's about a visible, materialistic world. But this is about something that happens in our lives every day, but we don't know about it. It's the transformation of knowledge, transforming from one dimension to the others. It's like the story of this person who was living in this, the boxes, level, layers. And this is what the message is about to humble us and to know that there is many layers of knowledge. One person, you get the knowledge and you think that you get it, you know that you don't get anything. When you say, as the ulama said, "Man qala alimtu faqad jahal," whoever say, "I get the knowledge," means he's the most ignorant person. Because as much you know, as you know that you don't know. The same things, when we find out about this planet, it was one question, what's this? When you find about the planet, 100 questions came. What kind of planet? What kind of weather? What's the planet? What's the year? What's the day? You see the many people, they don't go from this level to the level. So when you find out it's a planet, you find out that you don't know a lot about this planet. You find out that there is many questions that you don't know more than you ever think. And this is what Musa alayhi salam is going to do. So he asked him politely, and the response came as a rules of learning, class rules. What's the rule of the class? And this is the first thing. The answer, as every successful teacher, the first day, the first thing to do, the rules of the class. Raise your hand, do this, listen to each other, and we have the rules. What's the rules of the class of Al-Khadr? This is the rule. قَالَ إِنَّكَ لَن تَسْتَطِيعَ مَعْيَ صَبْرَ. The first thing he said, is going to be very hard. I don't think you have enough sabr, patience, to be my student. So, and this is assessment, realistic assessment. What you do before you go to class, you do a test, placement test. I don't think you can fit in this class. It's too hard for you. Don't go to algebra too, and you don't never study any math. So he said the first thing, قَالْ وَكَيْفَ تَصْبِرُ عَلَى مَا لَمْ تُحِطْ بِهِ خُبْرًا. This is another pedagogy we learned from teachers. When you give the answer, you explain why. Many parents, many teachers, no or yes. No, you cannot do this. This man, he has the pedagogy. What he tell him, he said, you cannot, how you can have patience with things that you don't to hate. Your knowledge cannot surround it. It's a different, completely different experience and dimension. Qala, response of the student, response of Musa alayhi salam, Qala satajiduni insha'Allahu sabiran wa la a'asi laka amra. Determination, he want to learn. He traveled for this month. He cannot give up. He say, oh, it's too hard for me. Okay, jazakallah khair, assalamu alaikum. No. He said, insha'Allah, you'll find me with patience. And you for sabiran wala asi, I'm not going to disobey, I'm going to follow the rules. And this is how the star comes. قال ولا أعصي لك أمرا. قال فإن اتبعتني. If you decide, and you know the mission is not easy, if you decide to come with me, this is the rules. قال فإن اتبعتني فلا تسألني عن شيء حتى حتى أحدث لك منه ذكرى. Rule number one, don't ask me about anything that I did until I give you the reason. So don't disturb the procedure. When we're done, I'm going to give you the explanation. He said, it's okay, this is what Musa alayhi salam. قال حتى أحدث لك فانطلق. So this is the main rule. Don't disturb the procedure. Wait and have sabr, and I will answer you. I will give you the answer. And فانطلقَ. This time, the journey. And the first journey was with the people who recognized Al-Khidr. But they didn't recognize Musa alayhi salam. Khidr, it seems, he's a known person in this area. He's not somebody who's magically appeared. It's not like this, it's a regular person. And he opened the discussion about does Al-Khidr live forever, as some people believe, or not. Most probably he's just a regular person. He died, as everybody, and there is many adillah, we don't want to go there. But they start with these people, they have a boat, and Allah described them as masakeen, poor people. They have a boat, he said, we're going to give you ride for free. And Musa alayhi salam, and the ghulam, and Al-Khidr, they went inside this boat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فانطلق حتى ذا ركب في السفينة خرقها. I want to say something about the amazing style of the Quran. Style that doesn't go for the details but go quickly. And it's amazing. If you read the Arabic, how the story been set together, it's an amazing and miracle of the Quran. So the first thing that he did when they arrived, he took him in خرقها, make a hole in it. First thing. Musa alayhi salam, he was shocked. This is the man that Allah sent me to learn from him. These people were very kind and very nice with us, and they give us free ride. And he did what he did. He took something and make a hole in the boat, and the boat starts sinking. He said, something is wrong with this man. Musa alayhi salam. قَالَ أَخَرَقْتَهَا لِتُغْرِقَ أَهْلَهَا لَقَدْ جِدْتَ شَيْئًا إِمْرًا. Remember with who you deal, with Musa alayhi salam. Musa alayhi salam doesn't have, he doesn't play politics. Musa alayhi salam, he has right or wrong. He stand up against Fir'aun. He stand up against the most aggression king in the earth. He stand up, he doesn't know, and this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him a person of haqq and stand up. And many people always, Musa alayhi salam is the symbol of standing against the falsehood and the wrong. He's angry, but angry in the haqq, in the truth. So to see something happen in front of him, with this way, he's not going to stop. He isn't going to accept it. He said, you did something wrong and weird and not acceptable. He smiled the Khidr and he said, قَالَ أَلَمْ أَقُلْ لَكَ أَلَمْ أَقُلْ إِنَّكَ لَنْ تَسْتَطِيعَ مَعِي صَبْرًا. Didn't I tell you that you cannot have patience with me? Then Musa alayhi salam, remember the rule number one, be patient and don't ask until the decision finished. So he said, قَالَ أَلَمْ أَقُلْ لَكَ قَالَ لَا تُؤَاخِذْنِي. Forgive me. It's something new for me. This is something all my life, I see something wrong, I stand up. This is something different. لَا تُؤَخِذْنِي, please forgive me. قَالَ لَا تُؤَخِذْنِي لَا تُؤَخِذْنِي بِمَا نَسِينَ, I forgot, بِرُوْ وَلَا تُرْهِقْنِي مِنْ عَمْرِ عُسْرَ, and don't take it too hard with me. I want to learn. I still want to learn. And then he said, فَانْتَرَقَ again. He said, it's okay, let's go again. فَانْتَرَقَ حَتَّى إِذَا لَقِيَ غُلَامٍ فَقَدَ لَهُ. And this is a very, more anybody. He came in the way and he find the child, the young boy, and he killed the boy. For Musa alayhi salam to kill an innocent people. For Musa alayhi salam who saw Fir'aun killing Bani Israel and doing this crime. So I stand up against Fir'aun because of this killing. And now you want me to accept what you just did? An innocent child. قَالَ فَانْتَرَ قَالَ فَقَتَلَهُ قَالَ أَقَتَلْتَ نَفْسًا زَكِيَّةً بِغَيْرِ نَفْسٍ لَقَدْ جِئْتَ شَيْئًا نُكُرًا. He said, you killed an innocent soul with no reason. This is something munkar. This is something I cannot accept. And this is وأدبر نكرة قال ألم أقول لك إنك لن تستطيع معي صبرا. With the calm, this is a completely different way. Calm, I told you, you cannot have patience. قال ألم أقول لك إنك تستطيع. قال إن سألتك عن شيء بعدها فلا تصاحبني قد بلغت من لدني عذرا. He remembered that this man, it's not a regular man. Allah sent him to learn from him. This is, it's not regular person. He said, let me make a deal. If I ask you about anything after this, I don't stay with you. And he's fair. He said, if I ask you, Rasulullah said, this is the biggest mistake that Musa did in this story. He said, if me and Musa let things go, we learn more and more and more from this man. But Musa, he said, he was innocent. He knew that he did something wrong. He said, look, I'm going to give me one more chance. If I ask you without permission, you have right to end this journey. So hadith of Rasulullah, he said, Rahimallah Akhi Musa. We wish that Musa didn't give him this sentence so we can learn more about Al-Khidr. So, قال فانطلقا, and they start again. حتى إذا أتيا أهل قرية. You are very tired, very hungry, and we arrived to the small village and city. They said, normally the people, they don't have to ask them for food. If they see that you are a traveler, they ask you, do you have water, do you have food, can we feed you? The first thing, they came to them, and they asked them, do you have food? To feed us, we are hungry. فأبوا. He said, no. We have no food, we're not going to feed you. Very rude way, very impolite way. قال فاستطع ما أهلها. They asked for ta'am, for food. فأبوا أن يضيفوهما. Reject them. They say, you have nothing for us, go away from our city. Very rude people. فوجد فيها جدارا يريد أن ينقض. Now they are being rejected. They've been kicked out from the city. They go out from the town or city. And Al-Khadr, he saw a wall and going to fall of his house. He said, start fixing the wall and bring, and Musa alayhi salam was shocked. He said, these people, they kicked us out. They refused to give us the basic needs as traveler. And you stand up here and you want to fix their walls. Something he said, this is what exactly موسى عليه السلام فقال قال لو شئت لاتخذت عليه أجرا. He said, I think what you did is wrong. At least you could ask them for some money for fixing this wall so we can go and buy some food. We are suffering and you do العمل الصالح, you are fixing the walls of them. Something is, doesn't make sense. And all the story about what's looked doesn't make sense for us. قال هذا فراق بيني وبينك. I'm going to follow the rules that you put. This is the end of it. But I'm going to explain to you, and this is what he said. قال هذا فراق بيني وبينك. سأنبئك بتأويل ما لم تستطع عليه صبرا. I'm going now to give you the answer, the explanation for things that you didn't have patience for. فأما الغلام and start talking, this is the explanation. أما السفينة فكانت مساكينة. He said, the first boat that you didn't see the reason for it. This مساكين, these poor people, they have only this سفينة. They work with it. This is the tool of their, they get food with it. They feed their children. They don't have any other things that they risk, source of risk except this boat. He said, so this is why you make all in it. He said, listen, and listen to the rest of the story. He said, at that moment there is a king, a wrongdoing, an aggression king, outside in the ocean. يَأْخُذُ كُلَّ سَفِينَةٍ غَصْبًا. He will take all the boats and attack people and kill people and take their boats and everything they have. So I made this hall to slow them down. So after they fix the boat and go back to fishing or whatever that they have, the king and his people would be already passed. Musa alayhi salam get shot. This is something I cannot understand. This is something beyond my knowledge and my understanding. You did something that in check, the people who play checks, it's like 3-4 move ahead. You think about right now, Musa alayhi salam, what's going to happen? This is poor kids and you did something wrong. Al-Khidr, it's 2-3 other move ahead. So thinking about something that you cannot think about, it's to protect these people from this king who are waiting to take all the boats and all and kill people. So I protect their lives and I protect their source of wealth or income. This is a little bit tricky. قال وأما الغلام فكان أبواه مؤمنين. This is about this young boy. Father and the mother of this boy, they are mu'minayn. Mu'minayn means true believers. And we have to know the difference between mu'min and Muslim. You can be somebody Muslim, but the iman, it's another level. قالت الأعراب آمنا قل لم تؤمنوا ولكن قولوا أسلمنا. The hypocrites outside of Medina, they said, we are mu'mineen. Quran said, tell them you're not mu'mineen. You are muslimin. You follow the rules, you come to the masjid, you do what's outside, but you don't. وَلَمَّا يَدْخُلُ الْإِيمَانُ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ Iman didn't touch their hearts. So Allah described the father and the mother of this boy, that they are mu'mineen, mu'mineen. وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا قَالَ وَكَانَ أَمَا الْغُلَامُ فَكَانَ أَبَوَاهُ مُؤْمِنَيْنِ فَخَشِينَا أَنْ يُرْهِقُهُمَا طُغْيَانًا وَكُفْرًا They are fear that this child grew up and going to give them hard time. And this is a very powerful message. The children are a mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا. But sometimes they can be نقمة, not نقمة. نقمة in meaning that bring unhappiness and bring no peace in the life of their parents. This is why look to all the fathers of the mother who prayed in the Quran, they always ask for something. What Ibrahim alayhi salam said? قال ربي هب لي من الصالحين. هب لي, give me children, but condition, righteous children. Because Allah can give you children, but the children can give you the hardest time. Zakaria, what's his dua? قال فهب لي من لدنك وليا يرثني ويرث من آل يعقوب واجعله ربي رضيا. Condition. Help me, give me, معناها child to take the earth, to take the knowledge of the children of Yaqub, but I want him رضيا. رضيا means somebody obedience child. Somebody who is righteous, somebody who brings the happiness to you. So this is why sometimes people, they just ask for children. Oh Allah, give me a child. I don't have children. Oh Allah, give me children. Never say that. Because the children can grow up and become this dua. Allah, give you what you ask for, but give you something that cannot be pleasant. So these two parents, they have this fear that this child is going to grow up and give you, going to give them hard time. Doesn't mean he's going to be careful, but he's going to give them hard time. Hard time. قال فأراد أن يبدلهما ربهما خيرا منه زكاة وأقرب رحما. He wanted somebody at that moment who closer to them and has more rahma and mercy to them. And this is their wish and their prayer. And Allah accepted their prayer and this event happened and the child died, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replaced them with other children. قَالَ وَأَمَّا الْجِدَارُ And the last one, the wall. Look, this jidar, which is bad people in this city. قَالَ وَأَمَّا الْجِدَارُ فَكَانَ لِغُلَامَيْنِ يَتِيمَيْنِ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ It was owned by these two orphans. And وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا قَالَ أَنْ يَبْلُغَ أَشُدَهُمَا وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا Their father was a righteous man. And their father, he knows the people of the city and you cannot trust them. So he took the treasure, whatever money he had, and he put them under the wall. The fear he had, these two young children, if the wall fell at that time, the people of this bad man, no manners people, they're going to take the money of the orphans. And they're not going to give them to them.
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a goal from that. قال فأراد ربك أن يبلغ أشدهما ويستخرج كنزهما. So Allah wanted to give them time again. It's to buy more time so they can grow up and they're going to find out their treasure. So and as again, فأراد ربك أن يبلغ أشدهما ويستخرج كنزهما. ويستخرج كنزهما رحمة من ربك. This is mercy from your Lord. So things delay sometimes, it has a purpose. It has a purpose. The most important word that he said from all of this, وَمَا فَعَلْتُهُ عَنْ أَمْرِي. I didn't do this by myself. I didn't do what I did just by because I thought about this. It's not that I'm very smart and I find out all of these things and I did this by myself. This is commands from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is what proved this man is a prophet, is has connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He received revelation to do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted him to do. قال وما فعلته عن أمري ذلك تأويل ما لم تسطع عليه صبرا. This is the interpretation of things that you couldn't have and that you didn't have enough sabr. And this is what's going to come to us. And this is what the purpose of this things. This is the last story. So this is the story, the part of Surah Al-Kahf that we're going to talk about it and learn from it. First, and the most important things, the connection with the qada. This is what everybody has to know. When I know about that there is deeper reason for things that happen to you. Wake up in the morning, my car, you know, the flat tire. Very similar. People, somebody get angry, you know, and do what the Jahiliyyah people do, rejecting the qada of Allah and not accepting. And we have to understand the qada, because this is about the qada. It's about being able to make peace with things that you cannot change. Something that you didn't think about. You have no option. Just wake up and something is happening, like what happened to the Safina. Many people, they react in a way that show that they reject the qada of Allah. There is things that you cannot change it, and you reject it. And this is, you know, part of our faith. And always people, we don't take it seriously. When we say Bunyan is the sixth pillar of faith, the last one, al-ridha bil-qada. Means what? Things that you cannot change, you have to make peace about it. You have to accept it. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us, always remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, say, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. And this is the sign of the true faith, that you accept the qada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you make peace with things that you cannot change. If it's my responsibility, I didn't put the seatbelt, I didn't follow the rules, I blame myself. But if something that I cannot change it, what I have to do? I have to accept it with an open heart and make peace with it. And this is where a lot of failures happen. The woman who was crying in the cemetery when the Prophet ﷺ passed by, and she said, her husband died. And she cried and said, why me? Why me? And Rasul ﷺ said, he told her, asbiri wahtasibi, have patience. And accept the qada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is nothing you can do. And Allah is going to test everybody without doubt. So she said, you don't know what I'm going through. Rasul said, he keep walking. And the man came to her and said, you don't know, you talk to who? She said, I don't know. He said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She ran to the messenger. Ya Rasulullah, sabartu wahda sabtu. I have patience and I hope in the reward of Allah. Rasulullah said, إِنَّمَا الصَّبْرُ عِنْدَ الصَّدْمَةِ الْمُوْلَى. The true sabr is when the sadma, the shock, the first shock. How are you going to react? You're going to say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ رَضِيْتُ بِقَضَائِكَ. Or you're going to say something, as Rasulullah said, when the Sahaba, they saw him, Rasulullah teaching the Sahaba, when his own son Ibrahim died, Rasulullah was crying, Rasulullah said. And there is nothing wrong. Sahaba, Ya Rasulullah, you're crying? He said, إِنَّ الْعَيْنَ لَتَدْمَى The tears come from the eyes. And وإن القلب لا يحزن, I feel sad. ولا نقول إلا ما يرضي ربنا. We say only what pleases our Lord. And this is, it's not about sadness, and this is a procedure, a healthy procedure. But the problem, do you reject the qada or not? Because the problem of this shock, it's the long-term effect. The way that you receive the bad news, may Allah protect all of us, it's the way that's going to determine how you're going to deal with the musibah. So this case, three cases that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given to us. If this young masakeen, they're going to look to their boat sinking, and this is the only thing that they have, they said, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Let's fix it and go work. Other people know that this is wrong and this is what's happening, and rejecting the qada. And all the story about this healing. And these two, they come together. Humbleness against arrogant, and peace against the rejection of the qada. There is a lot of things we can learn from this. I don't want to keep you long. But these two things, if I learn in our life, that my knowledge is a very limited knowledge. If I learn that things happen for a great reason, my life will be much, much better. And this is the purpose of all of this. Humble, and we know there is knowledge that we don't know. وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. And the second thing, we don't know what's good. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. Sometimes you dislike something, but it's the best for you that it happened. وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ. And sometimes you love something, and you don't know that the all evil and bad, it's what you love there. And that reminds you of what Bilal, always I like this example, because we do counseling sometimes. And the Bilal, when he went to ask to marry one of the sister of one of the great Sahaba from Quraysh, this is ex. He was a slave in Mecca, and he went to ask to get married. The words, now the Sahaba understand. He said that we are coming, me and my brother, to ask for your daughters. If you give us, alhamdulillah. If you say no, Allahu Akbar. And the smile in his face. If the people, if you give us, Allahu Akbar, if you don't give us, shame on you. And this is how the people act. It's always about, and they course. But this Sahaba, they have a completely different approach to the life. And this is why they live their life happy. Sahaba, they don't have a lot of money. They don't have a lot of, their life, but they were the happiest. They went through the toughest time in their lives. But they still have time to make jokes and to laugh and to come together. Sahaba, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went through, he been kicked from his city. He left his mother when he's 6 years old, she left his mother. He went through all the suffering, but he still have time to smile, have time to make jokes, and to go forward in the life and don't give up. The problem, if we don't understand this message, our life will be harder and more miserable. But the people who believe, as again the ayah, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ. I stop here, and if you have any questions, inshallah, we can go from there, inshallah. Anybody has a question?
Yes.
I'm sorry?
Is there like a bird or some other thing on
the... Yeah, this story of the bird when they arrived, the very important story, just like Allah Khairan. When they rode this boat, Musa and the Khidr, Allah sent the bird. And this bird, with its beak, touched the water of the sea. And so Al-Khidr turned to Musa alayhi salam. Did you see the amount of water that the beak of this bird took from the ocean? He said, yes. He said, my knowledge and your knowledge compared to the knowledge of Allah, it's less than the amount, the percentage of water in the beak of this bird. To prepare him, to don't get arrogant, there is a lot of knowledge that we don't know. There is a lot of things that we don't know. Jazakallah khair for iman. Yes. There is some people believe that he's still alive, but we don't have a strong belief for that. He said one of the four, Prophet Elias and Prophet Isa and him, and there is four who are still alive, but there is no really strong belief. There is debate among the scholars about it. Yes.
Okay. Just to add to what he said.
Okay.
But when Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that, what is special about tonight? The Sahaba said, each of us was told that whoever is alive tonight will not be alive 100 years from tonight. Whoever is alive tonight will not be alive 100 years from tonight. Whoever was on the earth.
There is a few ahadith, we have to be very careful. Some ahadith, weak ahadith, about the life of each other, that he's alive. There is some weak ahadith, there is a debate among the scholars. This is part of the aqidah. If you believe that he's alive right now, part of aqidah, we have to be very sure. So I don't want to really take one. Then the sister have a question there. Yes. And making sure what? Very good. The question is how to accept the qada and stand up against injustice and corruption. It's a very good question. There is a fine line about it. We know from the teaching of the Quran that there is a group of mustad'afin, oppressed people. They're going to come on the day of judgment. And the malaika, they are wrongdoers. Because they ask them, فِيمَا كُنْتُمْ قَالُوا كُنَّا مُسْتَضْعَفِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Their justification that they support the aggression, that they have no option. They ask us, they order us, so we have to follow the orders. So the malaika respond to them, أَلَمْ تَكُنْ أَرْضُ اللَّهِ وَاسِعَةٌ فَتُهَاجِرُ فِيهَا. Wasn't the land of Allah vast? So you can make hijrah. So saying I'm mustad'af doesn't justify that you do the wrong things. And this is exactly what the Sahara of Fir'aun did. The Sahara of Fir'aun, when he asked them, they rejected it. Stand up against Fir'aun. So standing against injustice, it's one of the great things, as Rasulullah SAW said, Sayyid al-Shuhada'i Hamza, the Sayyid of the Shuhada'i is Hamza. Wa rajulun, and the person, qama ila sultan al-jair, stand up for injustice ruler, fa'amarahu wa nahahu faqatalahu. So, qawlu al-haqi, as Allah said, qul al-haqqa, in the hadith, qul al-haqqa wa law ala nafsika. If you see something wrong, you try to say it. And Allah is going to ask us if we don't, in a way or the other, we don't stand up against the injustice. Even if, especially if it's for the other people, not for us. So accepting it, it's not ridabul qada, because you have option to change it, and change it at least with your hand. If you cannot change it with your tongue. If you cannot change it with your heart. But you cannot live in peace with injustice. The injustice is not qada from Allah, it's action of the other people. So this is why. But if you try everything and you cannot change it, Allah is not going to ask you why you didn't change the injustice. Allah is going to ask you why you didn't try to change the injustice. It's not a result. It's all in the hand of Allah. So there is two things. And many people, they use the concept of the qada to mess up the life. And unfortunately, the Muslim world, the many places, they use the qada in the wrong way. Even things is qada. You cannot change anything. Just accept it. Don't accept the wrong things. Rasulullah, if he accept what's in Mecca, we don't be here today. But Rasulullah, he made hijrah, he did his best. He worked very hard to change the situation. So again, the rule is very simple. Things that you cannot change, you accept it. Things you can change, you have to try to change. Conclude with one or two questions, yes?
Less knowledge than someone else.
It's not, again, this is why I mentioned the question is, does Musa have less knowledge? It's not about less or more knowledge. It's about area of knowledge. So Musa alayhi salam, he has a knowledge in this area, and he's a'lamun nas, he has more knowledge than anybody in his time. But there is another knowledge, area of the knowledge, that the
Hadith.
Yes.
Hadith.
Oh, this is what we said in the beginning.
Yes.
This is how it started. This man, he told him, do you know anybody who has more knowledge than you? He said, I don't know. Because he didn't know there is another area of knowledge that it's not part of his knowledge. So he said, no, I don't know anybody who has more knowledge than you. Yes. So there is hadith about it, and this is what I mentioned in the beginning. The reason of this story is this hadith. Last question, man. This is a good question. Many people, they say, they have fear that I cannot change these things, anything. They cannot change the basic things. And this is why we learn from the Prophet ﷺ, tawakkal ala Allah. Keep your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the things that I cannot change, mostly things that I born with. Very limited things that you cannot change. It's things that you cannot change who's your father, who's your mother, your ethnicity, whatever way that you are, a disaster that out of your power. Even if the disaster happened, the question Allah will ask us, did you prepare yourself for this? You know that the hurricane is coming, did you do your best? It was. But if something happens suddenly, and I have no option, the fear that the people will think that everything is you cannot change. It's not true. You can change almost everything. But the things, if you have the determination, and we are obligated to change the munkar. I come back to your question. Allah asks us to change the wrong. مَنْ رَأَى مِنْكُمْ مُنْكَرًا فَلْيُغَيِّرُهُ. If you see something wrong, if you see aggression, if you see abuse, if you see injustice, you have to change. So mostly, very limited things that we cannot really change. It's out of our power, out of our ability. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to come together to change things. If you cannot change it by yourself, there is people can help you. And this is what Rasulullah did. Slavery and Bilal, he couldn't change the slavery. What Bilal said, a very important story. Bilal, he said, for 19 years, I was carrying the umbrella for Umayyah ibn Khalaf. I never asked myself why I'm doing this until I said, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله. He said, when I know Allah is my Lord, not Umayyah ibn Khalaf, then I get empowered. And I know that this is not qada for me, that Umayyah ibn Khalaf is my master. This is things test from Allah and I have to change it. And he did change it with the support of the Sahaba. Many teaching and many ideology and religion became to justify the injustice. As in Europe, in the mid-age, it was, if you say, and many now, even some Muslims they try to do, they say the aggression, the king is the shadow of God on the earth. So the church played in France, for example, they prayed a very alliance, made alliance with the monarchy to justify the aggression in Europe. The moment, this is why one of the rules of the French Revolution, it's hang the last king by the instant, the guards of the last priest. He said, we're going to get rid of the last king by killing the last priest. Because it was an alliance between the monarchy and the church against the people. So this is why some role that the people try to justify the injustice. You have no right to come out of the... I was listening day before yesterday about this debate about al-khuruj an al-hakim, to stand up against the hakim of Zalim is permissible or not in Islam. And there is a lot of hadith and ayat talking about you cannot justify the wrongdoing. It's an obligation to change. Either social situation, political situation, any situation that it's wrong, it's not qada, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want us to suffer and doesn't like the wrong. As Allah said, conclude with this, قال الظلم ظلمات حديث الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم the aggression is the darkness in the day of judgment and the obligation of the believer is to change the ظلم at any level and this is the message so may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to learn from this. There's a lot of things you can learn from this story I want to encourage everybody to go reflect about it think about it and how the story it will humble us and make us happier by accepting the qada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looking for the wisdom behind the outside event that happened to us that's our dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase our knowledge and we ask Allah subhanahu allahumma zidna ilm allahumma allimna ma yanfa'una وانفعنا بما علمتنا اللهم كن معنا ولا تكن علينا وانصرنا ولا تنصر علينا وانصرنا على من بغى علينا اللهم انصر عبادك المستضعفين اللهم لقد قلت وقولك الحق ونريد أن نمن على الذين استضعفوا في الأرض ونجعلهم أئمة ونجعلهم الوارثين اللهم انصر عبادك المستضعفين في كل قدر وحيد اللهم اغفر لنا أجمعين اللهم تقبل صيامنا اللهم تقبل قيامنا اللهم بلغنا ليلة القدر يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم بلغنا ليلة القدر يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم اجعلنا عتقاء شهر رمضان آمين آمين وصلى اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم جزاكم الله خيرا والسلام عليكم